Hashet Audio presents The Other Fab Four, the remarkable true story of the Liverbirds, Britain's first female rock band. Written by Mary McGlory and Sylvia Saunders. Read by the authors.
Prologue. It's 6th of June, 1964, and we're four working-class girls from Liverpool, on our way to support the legendary Chuck Berry, the inventor of rock and roll. We can't believe it. We only arrived in Hamburg a week ago to play a short residency at the famous Star Club, the place where the Beatles honed their sound. And now we're going to be on stage with our idol. We've never flown before. But the four of us are on a shaky propeller plane with star bands, Ian and the Zodiacs, Lee Curtis and the All-Stars, King Size Taylor and the Rattles. When we take off, our bass player Mary is so terrified she grabs hold of an All-Star, nearly scratching his arm off. As soon as we touch down in Berlin, we are taken in a limousine to the massive Deutschland Halle, with 11,000 people already waiting inside. There is no sound check, and then, just before going on stage, the stage manager drops a bombshell. We can't do any Chuck Berry songs. We look at each other. That's what we've spent the previous week rehearsing. How are we going to play two 20-minute sets without a Chuck Berry? We walk out on stage in front of the biggest audience we've ever seen. We've never played anywhere this size, and as soon as we start playing Roadrunner, we realise that the acoustics are terrible. We had no idea that everything would reverberate back, so it's impossible to hear each other. After soldiering through the first set, we sprint to the bar, but scarcely have time to drink a shandy before the promoter barks over the microphone, "Liverbirds, back on stage." We hurry back on in a panic, but the crowd are cheering. Ah, we couldn't have been that bad. The reaction gives Val, our normally quiet lead singer and guitarist, a burst of confidence. "Blow it," she says. "We're doing Roll Over Beethoven." "You can't! Roll Over Beethoven, 1, 2, 3, 4. When we launched into the song, the crowd erupts. This is what they've been waiting for. And that's when we see him, Chuck Berry himself, with his slick, pomaded hair and chiseled cheekbones, glowering at the side of the stage. As I thwack the drums harder, he starts to pace behind me, swearing and telling me to stop. The next thing we know, Berry's manager runs on stage and yells in Val's face, "Stop!" "Fuck off," she retorts, and carries on playing. The second the song ends, Val announces, "Now, Johnny Be Good," and all the other Chuck Berry songs we can play. By now, the crowd are cheering and stomping so hard that Berry's manager melts away. At the end of the set, we walk off stage, elated. We've never known a feeling like that before. When we return to our hotel in the early hours, we find a message from our manager, Manfred Weislader, the owner of Hamburg Star Club. "I'd like to speak to you girls in the morning." Oh God, he doesn't want to manage us anymore. We've had it. After a fitful sleep, the four of us sidle into his office and sit nervously on his red velvet sofa. "Girls, I have to talk to you. We're about to babble our apologies. Sorry, we'll never do it again," when he says, "Chuck Berry's manager wants to bring you to America."
"What?"
"Yes, he wants to take you to America. We love Hamburg. We're enjoying the Star Club. But we've never been to the States before. The offer is tempting." Then, Manfred shoots us a look. "If you go to America, he will take you to Las Vegas. But he wants you to play topless." "We want to go to America, but don't take up the offer. Being treated as a gimmick
is just one of the challenges of being girls in the rock and roll world, and we don't let that put us off. We've already overcome obstacles to get here. We have each other and the music we love, and we're looking forward to more adventures. We've come a long way from the Liverpool cavern, and we're still only in our teens. Part 1, Liverpool.
Chapter 1, Mary. Dolly Dunn always has the best. I remember happy times playing with other kids in bombed outhouses, what we called the bommie. Living in Burlington Street felt cosy and safe. It was a small third-floor flat in an old Victorian terraced house near the docks, with a view of the chimneys of the Tate & Lyle sugar factory. The neighbours were close by, walking in and out of the flats, or drinking together in the Green Man pub on the corner. After last orders at 10 o'clock every Friday and Saturday, a crate of beer would be brought back to the flat and my uncles tinkled on the piano while Mum played the spoons and tap dance. Everyone sang until the early hours of the morning. Cockney wartime songs, such as We'll Meet Again, or Irish and Scottish ditties like Danny Boy or Loch Lomond. Mum was a brilliant tap dancer. When she was younger, she wanted to be like Ginger Rogers and she danced at all the parties. Dad was a burly man who had a lovely big voice, and in another life, he would have been an opera singer. He used to sing in the bathroom, making the words up. In many ways, he was misunderstood because he didn't often show his feelings. But when something did hit him, he'd be in tears with emotion. He felt things deeply. As a young child, I also loved going out with my grandma, my mum's mum, who was a fruit seller. Dolly Dunn was short and well-built, and one of my favourite things was to sit balanced on her handcart by the handlebars while she wheeled me up and down the dock road, shouting, "Fruit! Fruit!" It was a great feeling. People would gather round saying, "There's Dolly Dunn, let's buy her fruit. She's always got the best." She was the real money earner in the family. From Monday to Saturday, she'd get up early and go to the market to buy fruit and vegetables for the handcart, even in winter. On Sundays, she sold flowers outside Ford Cemetery, keeping them in bunches in a big basket that she carried on her head. She always had the freshest blooms. My dad's side, the McGlory family, were posh because they lived in a terrace house and always seemed to have the best food and nicest clothes. By contrast, Mum and Dad were constantly having to scrimp and save. In the winter, when it snowed, our flat was so cold that there were icicles inside the window, and we huddled round a small fireplace in the living room. Sometimes Santa didn't come at Christmas, and we just had an orange and an apple each, but there was always Christmas dinner. The size of the turkey depended on how well Grandma Dunn did with her barrow. We would all stand round the table while she brought in the bird, proudly placing it in the centre. It was my mum's job to pluck the feathers and get it ready. Even though we didn't get presents, this Christmas dinner made up for everything. My mother, Maggie, was tall, thin and very beautiful when she was young, but she had a hard life. My grandpa, James Dunn, was a docker who came over to Liverpool from Tipperary in Ireland, and my maternal grandparents were from County Louth, near the Northern Irish border. Mum came from a family of 10 children who lived down near Liverpool docks, only 5 of whom survived. In those days, bad sanitation, damp housing and poverty in general meant that many children died shortly after birth. At 5 o'clock every morning, Mum and her siblings would go to the railway tracks to pick up coal that had fallen off the steam engines and take it home for fuel. They went to school with dusty hands and were punished for wearing dirty clothes. The story of how my mum, Maggie Dunn, met my father, Joseph McGlory, is an unusual one. Her first love was actually Joseph's brother, Richard.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.